Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Denial and Addiction. And it is part of the Human Soul series. It was presented in Philadelphia, USA on the 22nd of July, 2012.
How is everyone today?
Good.
Yeah? Yes. After that confronting discussion we had last night.
I was really excited last night, but this morning.
Green one sticks on. Okay. Well, the subject we wanted to... Well, there's a couple of subjects we wanted to discuss with you today. The first subject is sort of joining from yesterday's discussion that we had, and also with the discussion that I had with a smaller group of people last night at the dinner table, at the restaurant. And so we'd like to sort of join on to that discussion today and give you a bit of background of the discussion last night. I know many of you who were actually listening to the discussion last night felt pretty confronted by what I was saying, because I was being quite firm about a lot of issues of love that exist, you know, around the planet, but particularly in Western cultures that are major problems with regard to love. Secondly, once we have done that, what we'd like to do is to talk to you about God's Way of Love Learning Centre in the USA, and we'd like to talk with you about the underlying principles of a learning centre. So what a learning centre is, what it's there to do, and those kind of principles. And then we'd love to talk with you about where we feel a good location would be for such a centre. Bearing in mind that most of the centres that we choose are in fairly remote or locations away from cities, not usually very close to a city, and we'll discuss with you the reasons why we're doing that as well. But what I'd like to do first, if someone again could handle our mics on this areas, doesn't have to be the same person. So it looks like you're the only volunteer though. So.
Yeah, up
and
the
you
back.
Got your disc, didn't you, that I did for you last night? Yeah. Yes, good. And yes, it'll mean just being on the ball a bit with when people put their hands up, I'll point to them. Remember, if you keep your hand up, then the person who's doing that will find it much easier for you. So the subject we'd like to raise with you is, it's part of the Human Soul series of discussions that we've been doing, and we'd like to talk to you today. Yesterday was more about fear and addictions. Today we'd like to talk to you about denial and addictions. A bit of a laugh there. Yes, so to give you a bit of background, in our discussion last night with regard to when we were at the dinner table, I started to raise issues that are very present in Western societies regarding the way in which we remain in denial about certain facts. And the facts that we often remain in denial about are all related to the emotions that we're also covering over. And a lot of the times we do not want to know what is really going on. Or we have a lot of very, very large things going on in our society that we feel we are not a part of, but there are emotions within us that actually cause us to be a part of. And last night in the discussion we had, I was talking about the emotions that were present in everyone in the room that contributed to America's response to the 9/11 event. Many of you felt that you disagreed with the event, the subsequent chain of events that occurred after 9/11, I'm talking about now. Many of you feel that you disagreed with the course of action of your government. But the reality is that many of you have an emotion inside of you that agrees with it, while at the same time, intellectually, you think you're disagreeing with it. Does that make sense? And we talked about the emotions of, for example, the emotions of desiring safety, desiring economic security, desiring security generally, desiring security from violence and all of these kind of facts, and how these feelings inside of you cause your government to feel that it can act on your behalf to prevent you from feeling those particular emotions.
Not just that it can, that it must.
That
actually.
It must, yes. And so every single person who has those emotions within them actually contributed to the subsequent events, whether they like to believe in their head that they did or not. Their soul feelings have caused a contribution to the subsequent events which caused America and other countries like Australia to join with America and the UK to join with America and attack Iraq. Does that make sense to everyone? And what we'd like to do is talk to you today a bit about the denial of that, how none of us want to face up to these kind of facts. Then I also raised an issue about how we treat children. And in the USA, you have a tendency to feel pride in the way in which you feel children. You feel treat children. You feel to generally that the country desires to treat children in a loving manner, and honours the family. For example, that is a big thing in the USA, is it not? And you often have family holidays or holiday events that involve the families getting together, particularly at Thanksgiving or Christmas time, where you get together as families a lot. And this is all a part of this facade, actually, that you have here in the States generally, that you actually care for children. And I talked about the facade because the reality is almost 50 million children die in your country every year. 50 million every year from abortion. They're actually murdered every single year. Right? And then I stated, how can a society, in one hand, say all these lovely things about, you know, how they feel that they love the family and love their children and so forth, and at the same time, often the very same people are willing to have an abortion when they have an unwanted pregnancy, which is actually the murder of a child. And what we start doing then in this subsequent discussion that happened, there started coming up all of the reasons why we think we should get away with that, or all the reasons why we think that such an action, for example, abortion, should be allowed in a developed society. And I'm not saying, actually, that you should stop it, right? I'm saying there's an emotion within the hearts of the individuals that allow it, and unless those emotions in the heart change, people will continue to do it. And as a society, there is this genuine feeling, and your society is very divided on the issue, is it not? You have one group of people who are militantly opposed to a person having an abortion, and then you have another group of people who are almost militantly approval of people having abortion, which some of them call them, what is it, the right to...
Choice.
Pro-choice and the right to lifers, I think you call them here, don't you? So it's pro-choice,
pro-life,
and pro-life. Okay. So and this is a big conundrum for the society in the end, because obviously the pro-lifers believe that they are children being aborted, and therefore being murdered. On the other side, you've got the pro-choicers who feel the woman has the right to determine what happens to her own body. And they believe that this developing child in her body to a certain time in the life is actually not a child, but it's actually a part of her body, and that she then should have the right to determine what happens to it. In addition to that, you have the medical profession analysing these children before they are born, and any potential of a defect is a trigger for a potential abortion. So what they do is they do some scans of the child and blood tests of the child, and then when they determine there is something wrong with the child, wrong in inverted commas, I must say, and a lot of times they're not accurate, by the way. There is just this potential for something being wrong. They inform the parents, and then many of the medical profession get quite insistent that the mother should have an abortion of those particular children, because they feel it takes a huge amount of demands upon society, that the society could use these resources for other things other than looking after these children that are potentially damaged of in some way. If you think about it, actually, it's not very different to creating a master race, is it? Which we have a lot of condemnation for Hitler, do we not? And yet many times our attitudes are still doing much the same thing as what he would have done in terms of selective determination of who is right, has the right to life and who does not. So these particular things are something we must consider. Now, what we do with these particular things generally is we have a lot of denial. We do not want to face what emotions are within us that cause us to be supportive of actions that are actually very unloving in society. Now, I'm not suggesting that we need to attack society and force society to have our opinion. I'm not suggesting that you need to create even more laws to prevent people from doing what they wish to do. What I am suggesting is that what is happening in the environment is an indication that there is something wrong in the hearts of the people involved in the environment. Does that make sense? So, and we all need, because we are living in this particular environment, we all need to examine what our part is, what emotion within us plays a part in the creation of these events. So, in the USA, for example, there's around 50 million abortions every year. There's around 250 million abortions around the world every year. And around 50 million of them occur in North America, around about that figure. And if you look at the entire of Western civilization, you know, that is currently on the earth, a large majority of the abortions occur in those locations. So that's a lot of children, is it not? These are not children that are accidentally dying. They're not children that are dying of malnutrition. They're children that are actually being taken from their life on earth on purpose. So they're being murdered, basically. And that's a lot of murders occurring in one location, which we are mostly in denial of. Almost every woman who does have an abortion goes through a lot of trauma after the abortion. But, of course, because they did want the child to be aborted, they also have a lot of denial about the particular feelings they have after the abortion has occurred. We know some people in the Western world that have had 36 abortions, or around that figure. And we know another woman who has had 20 abortions. So that's quite a lot of abortions, isn't it, to occur. Many of the people who are involved in abortion too do not understand the effect upon the soul of the child and the pain that the child itself experiences. And they do not understand either the effect upon their own soul, because it actually turns them into a murderer. And there is also, so then there is a large effect on their own soul negatively as well. So many of these women who have lived relatively moral and good lives all of their life on earth, when they arrive in the spirit world, arrive in a place of darkness, wondering why they've arrived there. And the reason why they wonder is because they've been in denial about the actual abortion, about what they've done. Does that make sense? Now, I've given a series of interviews about abortion with a lady who had abortions in Australia. And so I don't want to cover that particular subject specifically. What I'm using it for is an illustration of what happens inside of us emotionally to cause these particular things. And oftentimes we are in complete denial of what is really going on, what's the underlying thing that causes us to consider an act of violence towards another person, or causes us to desire an act of violence perpetrated towards another person from a government. So in other words, what causes us to desire our government to go and do something about somebody. Now, in this discussion, as I've said, I'm not recommending that we create more laws to control people, because in the end, people will do what they want in the long run. They will finish up doing it either under the table, as the saying goes, or in the black market or something like that, or openly, depending on whether the society allows it or does not allow it. If the society allows it, then the actions are often taken openly. For this reason, here in the States, you have even clinics that have only been created for the purpose of having abortions. On the other hand, and also you have a very large army. In fact, the largest, pretty close to the largest army in the world. I think the Chinese army is still a bit larger, but so you have a very large army.
A lot of weapons manufacture.
Last night we then talked about weapons and manufacture of weapons. Your economy, one third of it, is dependent upon the manufacture of weapons. So that means in this particular audience, if you stopped manufacturing weapons here in North America, in this audience, one third of you would lose your houses, one third of you would not be able to eat, one third of you would not be able to have enough clothes to wear, one third of you wouldn't have a car. Can you imagine the impact that would have on your society? Just taking all of that money out of your economy. So your economy and even your day-to-day life is dependent upon arms manufacture. And where do these arms get sold to or used upon? Do they get used here in the States primarily? No, they don't. They get used overseas. They get sold to third world countries generally, or they get used upon third world countries. They get used upon countries that cannot fight back most of the time. And huge amounts of our economic welfare has come from the production of these particular arms manufacturing. I think in your economy, I think there's something like $1 trillion spent every single few days, in fact, on arms manufacture. I don't know the exact figure now, but I remember around in the 1990s, there was something like $3 or $4 trillion spent on arms manufacture every year. And now, of course, it's much higher than that. Now, when you compare all of these things and you ask yourself the question, well, how can these particular things happen in a so-called loving society? The only way they can happen is by the society being in denial. That's the only way they can happen. And they have to occur by our emotions being in a relative agreement to these particular events. Now, let's look at the arms manufacture issues. Many of you would say, in your mind, I don't agree with arms manufacture. Many of you by now might even say, I don't even agree with war. Right? Here, that's what you say. But if your family was being threatened by another person, would you fight back? Now, many of you would fight back if put in the situation, which is an emotion inside of you which actually contributes to the whole idea of going to war. In addition, how many of you would be willing to lose your current financial position completely? Now, many of you are so stressed out about losing it that you'll even prostitute yourself in your day-to-day job because you don't want to lose your current financial position. Now, what if you had to lose your current financial position because the whole country decided that there'll be no more arms manufacture, and all of a sudden, all those people involved in those jobs got laid off? Then there's all the supporting jobs, like all the metal that's used and all of the materials that are used in arms manufacture. All of those jobs would be severely affected. Then there'd be the whole process of who can pay for food and who can pay how much welfare that you need to be involved in. And all of those jobs would all be affected. And before you knew it, your job would be affected, whether you liked it or not. Right? When you cut a third of a country's economy out, it's a huge effect on the entire country. Now, how many of you would be willing to support such a choice by your government? Yeah. Okay. You say that, but the emotion in you is not saying that. For example, you've said to me, you put your hand up with that, but you've said to me how stressed out you are about money and how stressed out you are about not having enough and having to work in a job that you don't like. That emotion is contributing to arms manufacture. If we use a mic. So you're putting up your hand. And there's a lot of hypocrisy in what you're doing right now.
But I so agree with so much of what you're saying.
I know you agree with it here, but your soul does not agree with it.
But what I would try to do is have the government divert that money that's used for arms to feeding the people who don't have jobs or creating jobs. Well, that's we'll try to work toward that.
Yeah, but that's what you say. But the emotion, this is what you're not getting. The emotion in you is saying something completely different. You have, if I can talk specifically with your emotions, if you don't mind, you have an emotion of a fear. These are some fears you have. One of fear you have is of economic disaster. This is why you work in a job you don't like, right? Now, this fear is saying to the world around you, don't make my life more difficult economically. That's what it's saying. That's the emotion coming out of you. Now, any choice the government now makes, anybody in the government is going to feel this particular emotion coming from you. And they're going, okay, we can't be honest with the people anymore. We're feeling their emotions, and we're feeling. And you look at what happens here with the government. If you have a downturn in the economy, how long does that government last? When there's a downturn in the economy, how long does the government last? The next election, it's gone. Generally, yes. And the reason why is because many Americans and most of you here in the audience have this fear of economic disaster. Ironically, you are in the end going to create economic disaster for your country by having this emotion. So you're not being honest when you put up your hand and say, this is what I think, when at the same time there's a feeling coming out of you that is very, very different. This is what denial is. What you just illustrated is denial. By not seeing that this emotion, this fear, contributes to the actual event. So in this fear contributes to war. That fear, and you're not seeing it, so therefore you're in denial of it. And if you don't see it, you can't change it. Does everyone see that? If you don't see it, you cannot change it. You cannot change what you do if you don't see what you're doing. And this is what everybody thinks. Everybody thinks that you can think something and things should change. And this is not how God's universe works. God's universe, all of the things that are attracted are based on what you feel, not on what you think. What you're attracting right now in your life is based on what you feel, not on what you think. This is why, you know, the whole concept that people have given you about the law of attraction, you know, this whole concept that I can think my way into prosperity. Yeah? It does not work. Many of you have tried it and you know it doesn't work. Right? You can't think your way into prosperity because in the end there's feelings inside of you. Remember yesterday, we had a list of all of the economic. I said, what happens if money comes away from your life? How would you feel? Do you remember that discussion? And remember we listed like 10 or 20, probably 30 different, and we didn't even really, in my opinion, list all of the things that we needed to list because there's a huge amount of issues that we have with trust with God and all sorts of issues as well that we could have listed. So the reality is every one of those emotions that we listed yesterday about money contribute to this fear of economic disaster. And that contributes to a country making a choice to go to war to create more economic prosperity. And how does it create more economic prosperity? By two things. It generates work in the country that goes to war, and it also generates the raping of another country's resources. So it actually creates prosperity in two different ways. And while we may say that we do not support it, emotionally, we are supporting it if we have that emotion in us. As soon as that emotion is present, we are automatically supporting. Does everyone understand that relationship? So we can put up our hand and we can go, right, no, I don't agree with this and I don't agree with that, while exactly at the same time, inside of us emotionally, we have the feeling, right, that supports that particular thing. So, for example, what would be the feeling that would support a person having an abortion? Is there any ideas? Just to give you an, this will help you, if you can analyse things a little bit more deeply, this will help you a lot to see what feelings create what events. So they're all fears, obviously, aren't they? So let's list the kind of fears that might be present if a person has an abortion. Yeah. So if we can have that mic come down, and then the other mic go up the back there, right up the back.
It could be a feeling of entitlement.
Entitlement of what, Mary?
To rid of the child, like it's my right to do that.
Right, but why would you feel you have a right?
What do you feel entitled to?
Like having that choice.
Yep, what does that choice give you?
It's like when you make a mistake and you can undo the wrong, this sort of...
Well, doesn't the choice give you a sense that you have control?
Right, it's control.
When you're pregnant, how do you feel?
Out of control. Right.
If you don't want the pregnancy, you feel out of control. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, you feel out of control, not just right at the moment, but you're going to be out of control for the next 20 years.
Right, exactly. Right.
So that's how it feels, right? So there's the fear is having no control of your life. That causes you to desire... having control, which means desire having choice, even when there potentially might not be a choice if you look at it from a love perspective. Right. Yeah? There you go.
Not being able to take care of the child.
Okay, so what's that all about?
Well, I think it depends on the circumstance.
Yep. So there might be an emotional feeling that you're not prepared emotionally to support or care for a child or love a child. Yes. Or it could be a physical feeling related to your welfare economically, where you feel like, I can't support a child, I don't have enough money coming in to support a child. Or it could be that you don't have the partner.
All of the above. It could be all of the above.
Could be all of these, right? So what are all of those, though? If we add them all together, they are all fears.
Yes.
But what kind of fears? What's the underlying feeling? So let's look at the fear of not having a partner. What's that about? Well, we can be general, but we need to be a bit more specific, I feel. Like, so, you feel alone. You're going to be supporting this child, bringing up a child that you don't know anything about and you've never had one before, perhaps, or you've got a couple of them already and you're already struggling, and you just feel like you're the only one doing it.
Or maybe you're not feeling able to even take care of yourself. You have those fears,
much less
to add on the additional...
So my life's already a mess and it's going to be more of a mess once the child comes along, yes? Okay. Can you see how... we could list hundreds, obviously, couldn't we?
Could we list a few, because there's a few kickers that I feel everyone has.
Sure.
So what do most people feel... Because some of the ones that you've listed are not the most major ones that I... That one I have heard a lot from people, that they feel inadequate to care for the child, they feel helpless. What's another huge one if you've gone to bed with someone... and now you're pregnant with their child, there's a huge fear that comes up for lots of women.
I was thinking shame, but in a different way, even shame around family and, you know, other people that you might have relationships with.
There's an even bigger one. Yeah. If you pass the mic just to your right.
Like you don't want to feel like you're going to trap someone or feel...
Maybe that you don't want to be connected to that person for the rest of your life.
Yes.
Exactly.
That is a huge feeling that a lot of people use to justify an abortion.
So why did you have sex? If you didn't want to be connected with the person for the rest of your life, why did you even have sex with the person? You've got to start questioning that, don't you? So you obviously didn't like the person that much. So why did you have sex? That was obviously a selfish act to get certain justification or certain satisfaction sexually. But you were willing to make that sacrifice. But now that you're pregnant, you don't want a connection to the person. So you feel like, this child is a connection to the person. This child means I'm going to be reminded of that person. Let's get rid of the child. So that way I can stay in denial that I even had sex with this person I didn't like.
And I don't have to work out any issue with that person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have to work out any emotional issue with that person. I don't have to even be reminded of the fact that I had sex with somebody I was ashamed of being with.
Yeah. There's another huge one that a lot of women have around their relationships with men and their relationships with their body. And violence towards them.
Any ideas?
Robin, yep. Yeah.
If we bring the... Just keep your hand right up, Robin. So, yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Shame?
Yeah, shame. I'll just say what I'm thinking about. Like, a lot of women have a feeling that it's not fair that I have to get pregnant from sex. it's not fair that I have to carry the child. It's not fair that I have to be the mother. And also there's a lot of carried emotion in both men and women about how women have been treated historically around sex. And so a lot of rage in the pro-choice camp is all about the fact that not what's happening now, it's about what's happened in the past. And lots of us have that emotion in us, and that supports this pro-choice idea a lot on the planet, that women have been harmed through sex for a long time and they should be able to now be angrily in control of what happens to their body. Yeah. So a lot of these feelings we all carry, and they actually, because our soul is the most powerful thing about us, not our mind and the belief systems we have. Coming out of our soul is this huge feeling towards other women that, no, you're right, we should be able to be in control here. We're not, and all of us actually feel powerless and out of control. And because we don't want to feel that, we want addictions, we want denial, so we go, you know, I'm a pro-choicer because that's the right thing to, you know, that's the good viewpoint to have.
A lot of pro-choices are really about rage with men not taking responsibility for the sexual act. A lot of it's about that, for example.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of rage with the opposite sex, yeah? So, have you noticed that when you're enraged, you don't sort of think very clearly? Have you noticed that? And so you don't go, maybe I'm killing somebody. Yeah. Because you don't even think that clearly enough to know that you're even doing that. There's just this, when you're enraged, there's this terrible justification inside of you for an action that you, in total denial, that it's unloving. Yeah.
And I suppose that's the point you're making, isn't it? Mm. A lot of us feel, I love children. I hate war. I would never participate in harming children or being involved in a war. But when we talk about the emotions that actually drive those things happening in our society, they've got nothing to do with children and war, and everything to do with fears that we don't want to feel. And so we, because terror and fear seem to be so insurmountable to us, something we will never conquer, that's our false belief, we immediately can start to justify things that with our rational mind, and even some place inside of us, we feel, oh, that's wrong. But because fear seems so big and we want to be in denial of it, we can justify internally a lot of actions that are actually very unloving.
Mm. Yeah. And that's really the point of what I'm getting to here. So in Western civilization, we actually have greater fears than other civilizations. And so what we finish up doing is we create laws to circumvent the fear. We create attitudes in the society to allow for the fear to occur. And in addition, we then, due to these fears, create events. Our soul is creating events that support our fears. And so when a government takes a specific action, they are often feeling the fear of the society that they govern, and then they take an action based on the sum total of all of those fears. Right? And this is the issue we face. We then, if you think about it, all bear a responsibility for what is happening if the emotion exists within us. And for the majority of us, the emotion does exist within us because we haven't addressed the fear at all. We've just sort of made out that it's not there. We haven't actually felt it and had it actually removed from our soul. And as a result, the fear is still within our soul, creating these events that we intellectually condemn. We're hypocrites, right? Because until we can see that this fear inside of me, this soul-based feeling inside of me that still exists, is creating the event that's negative, that's out of harmony with love, we are actually being hypocritical. While we're telling ourselves, I am not a part of that, while at the same time we have feelings that make us a part of it, we are being hypocritical in the analysis. And so what we do, and this is the thing that we always finish up doing, is we go, okay, there's no such thing even as the soul. There's no such thing even as the emotions creating events. Do you see what we do? We even deny, you know, so we finish up being totally resistive to accepting any of God's truth about the soul. Because if we accept the truths about the soul, then we've got to accept that the soul creates events, and then we've got to accept that if I have a certain feelings in my soul that support those particular events, then I'm a contributor to something that I don't even like. And rather than actually go through the acceptance of that and then work through the specific emotions that are involved with that, what we do instead is we go, no, there's no such thing as a soul. There's no such thing as these emotions. I don't even have them in me. That's what we do. And that helps us get out of the fact that it's in there, creating new things. All of our soul-based emotions are creating new things. Now, if they're fear-based soul emotions, can you see they're going to be creating a lot of negative things? And if they're loving, true-based desires, truth-based desires, can you see they'll be creating a lot of positive things? And this is where we do not understand the power of our own soul. We do not understand that while we're thinking one thing, our soul can be feeling and creating a completely different thing. This is why psychologists have come up with the concept of the, you know, the subconscious mind. Why does a person keep gravitating back to the same event over and over and again? Because the soul has feelings in it that is pushing them into those events, even when their mind says, I don't want to be here. Why does it, for example, why does a woman who was abused during her childhood or by her father or whatever, or have certain feelings about her father, why does she finish up attracting abusive men in relationships one after the other when he or she's saying, I don't want these men. Why do I keep getting these kind of men? Because she's in complete denial of the emotion that is creating the event. If she knew the emotion existed that was creating the event, do you think she'd be wise to actually release the emotion and then she would never attract one of those men again, one of those abusive men? She would walk in the door and be able to go, bang, 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 all of those people are all those kind of abusive men. She'd be able to feel every single abusive man in any environment if she released the emotion. But because she's in total denial of the emotion, what does she do instead? She walks in the door, and because we're in denial of the emotion, we actually attract exactly the men that here she's saying she doesn't want. But here in her soul's going, I need this guy to become aware that I've got a problem inside of my soul, right? To be aware that I've got a fear, that I've got some issues I have to deal with inside of my soul, and once I release these issues, then I won't keep on honing in on these particular guys. But instead of doing that, she says, oh, these guys are all bastards. Right? It's all their fault. And I've got no idea while I'm attracting these guys. It must mean that every guy on the planet's a bastard. And after a while, she actually believes that. Right? Because every guy she attracts is a person who eventually abuses her, and she's not focusing on the fact of why. So she remains in denial. Do you see? This is what we do. Denial is a very powerful tool that we use to get rid of emotion. We use it to stop ourselves from experiencing emotions we need to feel if we're ever going to grow. If we're ever going to get close to God, all of our denials have to be gone. All of them. Do you think God's going there, yeah, you know, you want a relationship with me, but actually you're totally willing to destroy one of my children, God's children I'm talking about, any time this particular emotion is triggered. So, for example, in the case of a fear of a person who's had an abortion or considering abortion, any time this rage with men is triggered, you're willing to kill one of my children. This is what God's thinking. Now, do you think you could ever be at one with God while that emotion exists? Of course not. Right? And yet, if you remain in denial that it exists, can you see that you just finish up stagnating yourself? You finish up wrapping yourself up in this self-delusional cocoon, and feeling like, no, I'm going good, everything's right in my life, I'm really good, and you start feeling like a sense of arrogance about your own life. But in the end, all these fears are really dictating what's going on in your relationship with God, in your relationship with everyone else, and in your relationship with yourself. And you're shutting down emotion after emotion after emotion, which is the same as shutting down your soul. So you're shutting down your soul. You're selectively trying to experience emotions. So you're trying to have nice emotions while you have these other emotions. And because we try to shut down these ones, we think we can selectively shut them down, and we can't. And so what happens is we eventually go numb. We go depressed. Why do you think, like, I think the figures are around 20% or so of women in highly developed societies are on antidepressant medication. Why do you think that is? It's because we're in a lot of denial of a lot of emotion. That's why it is. These are all the effects of denial. So now what Mary wants to do is join this up with this word, addictions. Is that okay with you? Because if you think about it, there are reasons why your addictions are maintained. And these reasons, there's many reasons which Mary wants to discuss with you, a few reasons, we should say. And they are all related to the desire to remain in denial. Yeah. So until we become honest about our denial, we are going to struggle to become honest about our addictions. Yeah. Mm. Okay.
Okay.
I'll sit down now and Mary can...
Right, I'll take the lead. I feel like everyone needs... AJ was so inspired right then. Does everyone need a breath? Because it's quite intense, isn't it? Yeah, so let's breathe.
And actually, I was thinking that last night, that's how many of you felt like you needed to have a breather from the discussion we had. Yeah.
I think God designed the truth to be overwhelming. That way we can, grabs our attention and we go, whoa.
Can I just say before Mary begins that, actually, we're not trying to condemn you here. Does that make sense? So there's a feeling in some of you of condemnation, but we're not trying to condemn you. We're trying to help you see, to become aware. Does that make sense? Because if you cannot become aware, it's going to be very, very difficult to ever get close to God, to get close to yourself, to actually have a happy life. Without awareness, it's impossible. So what we're trying to do is to sort of hit you between the eyes with a sledgehammer so you become aware. Does that make sense? And the reason why we want to do that is because without this kind of awareness, it's impossible to continue growing. You need to become so aware that you can feel every single thing inside of yourself that contributes to worldwide events if you really want to grow. Yeah.
Yeah. And I suppose that's something that I've heard reflected from a few different people this weekend is about sensitivity. Because really what we're encouraging you towards is like a very sensitive place. We're talking about denial and addiction, which is the things that keep us numb. And underneath that is like the wealth of emotion that you've been shutting down since you were conceived nearly. But even if you consider when you were a child, you were far more sensitive and wide open to the world, and you could easily discern when something was loving and not. Many of you feel so hurt from your experiences at that time and their emotions that you're going to have to grieve through. But the fear is, I can't even face how hurt I was from that time, let alone go back to a time when I'm just as sensitive again and I can feel everything around me. But that is what we're encouraging you to do, because actually the fear is telling you something false. The bad stuff happened, or the judgment or the condemnation of that place happened when you were little. And there's pain in there to feel and release about that. But once it's gone, you're an adult now, so you're able to be a little more in control of what happens in your life or make choices about what happens in your life. And so you're going to be able to respond in a more sensitive way. Just like AJ was explaining, you'll be able to discern everyone in the room who's going to potentially harm you and make good decisions from that place. Rather than trusting, as you when you were little, you didn't know how to trust these feelings inside of yourself, and many people told you they were silly. And so this is where all the doubt came in, and you ended up trusting people or being under the control of people who actually harmed you. If you're brave enough to go back to the sensitivity now as an adult, your life will be so much more joyful. And at the moment, living in denial and addiction, that's where the numbness is. That's where we're feeling like, where is the joy in my life? Where is the part of my life where I just want to sing? Because that's what you felt like when you were little and you were doing something you really loved. Singing and skipping and that kind of joy, that's the kind of joy that God designed for us to have. It's just that we're world weary right now because we're holding on to so much stuff. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so I wanted to just talk a little bit more about addiction from my own experience yesterday. And I see a huge relate, not from my experience yesterday, from my own experience following on from yesterday. But there's a huge relationship I see between denial and addiction. So lots of you got a good taste of what AJ was talking about in terms of denial. It's where we just really don't want to see what's inside of our soul. One of the main ways we use to support that place inside of us is by going into addiction. Because God, in his beautiful, loving wisdom, is bringing us events all the time to help us see what's inside of us. But because we want to stay in denial, we go, how can I avoid this? How can I get a feeling that's not scary or sad, but a happy one? I'll create an addiction. I'll create some relationships with people or my environment that help me avoid this strange, stirring up thing that's happening as I walk through my life. So I see a big relationship between denial and addiction. And really, as you come out of denial, the first thing you're going to see is all the addictions that you've been using to support your denial. And I've had a few discussions with people privately about them feeling frustrated about, I'm not getting to my tears. I know that grief is the healing emotion. I'm not crying for hours at a time. I just feel a bit, like, how am I going to get anywhere on this path? And the truth is, for everyone on the planet, because we're all basically in some level of this, most of us in a deep level of it, the truth is when we start our real soul work, we are going to be dealing mainly with addiction. And that means we're not going to be crying causal tears. We're going to be crying, I want what I want tears. This really hurts, this changing and becoming sensitive again. And so I always want to say to people, don't beat yourself up if you feel like you haven't hit five causals in the last 5 days, because I see that as a culture that grows out there, everyone, because of some other emotional injuries inside of us, of not wanting to feel helpless, not wanting to feel hopeless, not wanting to feel like we're not getting anywhere. We all then start going, did you cry? How much have you cried today? Yeah, I think I hit a causal, it was really deep, it was about my mum, all this kind of language starts happening and we want to feel like we're getting somewhere. But the truth is, in the beginning, we're just going to be looking at so much addiction. And it's going to be that feeling like you all just had when AJ just told you about two major things that are happening on the planet and how our own emotions support them. It's like a whoa feeling. And then, you start getting used to seeing one level of the addiction and the denial, and then God brings you something else to show you, like, whoa, there's even more in there. Like, there's so much I'm denying. And if we can get used to that kind of process and recognize that that is actually taking steps, that's the beginning of our soul work, then we're going to relax a lot more about this. Did you want to add something, babe? No. Yeah, so then we're going to get more relaxed about what's happening. And you can't actually start your real soul growth until you deal with addiction. And that, for me, for a long time, I really didn't like that truth. Because I was more happy to see, remember how it, we know how it all sits inside of us. There's grief right down there, and we've heard it's the healing thing. And actually, when we do connect with grief, we can feel like, whoa, that's a relief. I feel changed person. That was good. So we start to think, okay, grief is where I've got to go, and I'm a little bit more okay with that. But on top of grief is all our terror, and I'm going to call it terror because all of us have terror, plus fear. And on top of that is where we create these things. Addiction, denial, and our anger comes into play. Like after AJ's discussion with some of you last night, we went home and we could feel quite a bit of anger in spirits who were attached to you guys, going, we don't like that you've just exposed all this stuff in these people. We want them to stay in these places so we can keep control. So anger is a part of this process, and that's something else I want to say to you, that it's going to happen. And most of us are judging these places so much. We judge the fact that, yeah, I do feel really angry with men. I do think it's, you know, I do want to have control over other men so they can't control me. That's an emotion that exists in most women on the planet right now. And I'm going to keep my heart closed to him because if I open it and he treats me badly, I'll hurt and I don't want to have that. So that's an emotion that most women carry. And most of us, we'd prefer to, no, I want to feel grief that Dad hurt me. Because we can intellectually make the leap between that addiction and the fact that I've got some grief with Dad and feeling like he wasn't there. So we all just try to hit this grief and not deal with the fact that, actually, I've got a huge addiction to maintaining control in my marriage. I've got a huge addiction to feeling like I'm kind of powerful and in control as a woman. All these addictions are what we have, and I just want to stress it to you guys so much because I've tried to do it another way. I have tried. I have gone, yeah, okay. And I've had a soulmate pointing it out to me. I've had God's laws bringing me so many examples in a week just to show me I actually want control here. I'm actually quite angry with men. And then I've gone, well, I know anger, fear, under that's grief. If I just get to grief, that whole other pile will just be gone. It doesn't work that way. Because like AJ said yesterday, under emotion is emotion, and under that emotion is more emotion. And we can't, even if we emotionally connect to the addiction and then intellectually go, this is about pain with Dad, and then feel that emotion, it's never going to work. It's never going to work. We're going to have to feel that. Then when we've done that, we will start to feel that. It will start to happen. And if we're humble to that, then we'll start to feel grief. And we can't do it any other way. And trying to do it another way has only created so much more pain for me in my life. And that's why I wanted to stress it to you guys. Because many of you have probably seen the sleep state discussion I gave. And that was all about me for 3 years recognizing I have an addiction to not feeling powerless. I have an addiction to not feeling shame. I have an addiction to having control over my relationship and over men. And intellectually going, yep, I've got to deal with that. But really emotionally saying, I don't want to look at those things. I don't want to even acknowledge that they exist inside of me. I do not want them to be there. I judge myself if they're there. So I'm just going to, emotionally, that's what was happening for me the whole time. Or I'd try to have a little cry about it or try to connect it. It was all intellectual and it didn't change my soul at all. And it only put me further in denial and I created a whole series of other events that caused me a lot of pain and a lot more shame and eventually brought me to the realizations of what was inside of me. But I could have done it a very different way. Could have done it in a way where I recognized my addiction in the first instance and I said, okay, my block here is that I judge this about myself. If I can just work through the judgment I have about myself, about these sexual issues, then I'm going to start to really work on this addiction and work on my desire to actually be free of it. Then I would just be in the place that I'm actually in now, which is actually experiencing fear about those things. And once I did that, I would not be acting in addiction or denial or causing more harm to my soul or to other people's souls. But because I judged it, because I thought, no, I can't see this about myself, I can't really be that bad a person, that was my judgment of it, I then created more and more events, and God had to bring me more and more events to help expose that inside of me. And that was because I wanted also to feel like I was getting somewhere. I felt I needed to be better than I was. I felt I had a role, and all these other emotions that I didn't want to face also. So there is so much power in just right now recognizing maybe I'm not as evolved as I think I am. Maybe I'm living in huge amounts of denial and addiction because, hey, I live in the Western world. It's pretty much geared around these two things. Our whole society is geared to help us remain in denial or addiction. So if I'm looking at that logically and realistically, I'm probably in a lot of denial and addiction. And then if I look at the people around me and I can see they've got pain in their lives about these things, perhaps I might have some addictions that are helping me avoid that pain. If we can get to that place emotionally and say, okay, addiction is where I'm going to have to start. Emotion is going to be beneath emotion, not thought. And if I'm just willing to look at addictions and work through these emotions of judgment I have at myself, then I start my soul work. Then it begins, not before. Francie.
How do you work on the... I feel I'm the step above, that the denial is starting to fade.
Yes.
And how do you work on the judgment of the addictions? Because that's where I am now.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I just had to begin to recognize that I'm treating myself in a way that God is not even treating me. So it began almost as an intellectual process of, okay, I'm recognizing addiction inside of myself and then I'm just judging it. And that's actually shutting me down. It's actually self-punishment, which is something I learned in my childhood to help me placate people around me and into thinking that I was a nice person again. But also, I recognized that as an addiction also, in that it helped me avoid what was really going on. So every time I saw an addiction, I would just berate myself for being a bad person, and that just got me away from what I was really afraid of.
Can I add something there too, babe?
Yeah.
There's two primary problems with judgment of our addictions. The first one is that we're not recognizing that God only creates good things. So the reality is that all of us here, no matter what our addictions are, at the core of us is just a good thing, only a good thing, in fact. And that's what God created. That's what God's trying to lead us back to, that good thing that God created. So the first belief that we need to reinforce in ourselves when we have trouble with it, at recognizing our addictions and being open about them, is that God didn't create a bad thing here. So these bad things that are in me came from somewhere else. They're not a part of my core self. I feel what happens for a lot of people is that they believe the badness is a part of their core self. And so that's one of the reasons why they don't want to recognize it. The second thing I feel that creates it as well is this feeling of that I am somehow flawed, and that's the reason why I have this particular addiction. And what we're not doing there is we're not recognizing how the addiction arrived in our soul, and how it arrived in our soul was through events that usually occurred from the age of 7 and below. In our life, that's how it arrived in our soul. So it actually arrived in our soul through events that related to the environment up until a certain point in time, and then our choices that we made from those events later, of course, contributed to the addiction now being in our soul. But the core reasons are all related to our environment. And so what we have a tendency of doing, I feel, is placing responsibility, blaming ourselves when the reality is the environment created these addictions. And if you had been if you'd grown up in an environment with no addiction, then how likely would it be that you have these addictions? It would be quite remote, wouldn't it? Likelihood. The third thing I feel we need to do with those two first things, those two things that I've just mentioned, is understand that unfortunately, even though the environment has created these particular addictions, and even though God did not create them inside of us, and we're pristine inside, we need to just find that pristine person. Even those two truths are true, the only person who can feel anything about that's inside of ourselves is ourselves. So even though other people have been responsible for the creation of the badness, if you like, or the evil emotions that exist within ourselves, only we ourselves can actually clear it out now by a choice. We need to take an action ourselves. And I feel once we understand those particular things and remind ourselves of it, because there are going to be times when you feel bad, certainly, because it's terrible when you notice certain things inside of yourself that are unloving. But what we need to do is remind ourselves, God never created me this way, and I can return to the person God created by taking responsibility for what's in me, even though other people have created it, and feeling my way through it so that I can release it. And then you'll have far less blame of self in the process. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. That, and that was, yeah, if you pass the mic across to Liz, and I'll just share something.
Well, up to the person behind Liz first, if that's okay. Can I? Thank
you. Sure.
It's already
on. Yes, it's on.
You were saying about the 7 years old and the bad emotions being created in them. Why don't they have something in the schools where they have teaching parents how to raise children?
Well, I feel that's a wonderful question. The problem is that most people don't know anything about the soul. So they don't know the effect that the parents' emotions have on their child. They think that parenting's all about actions rather than emotions. And this is a primary misunderstanding of society about how things actually work inside of a human soul. Because there is this basic misunderstanding or even no knowledge at all about that particular thing on the planet, then even if we went to school to learn how to be a parent, we wouldn't learn how these emotions arrived in the child. And that's the core thing we need to learn. And so I feel what we need to have is teachers who firstly learn that themselves and then actually start this process of teaching parents that the real creator of the child's problems, physical as well as emotional, are all related to the denied emotions in the parents and the environment. And if we did that, then teaching the child that and teaching the parent how to parent would be a fantastic way of clearing away. And you could, if you think about it, if you taught the entire generation of new parents those particular truths, the next generation of children would be greatly freed of emotional burdens. And then the following generation, imagine what the following generation would be like. It's just like, it's almost unimaginable. Within 2 to 3 generations, we could potentially have children having no emotional injuries whatsoever when they're being born, and no emotional injuries between the age of 0 to 7. Imagine what kind of children they would be. But unfortunately, we need to firstly understand at in a large society level, we need to understand how important the soul is and how these emotions are transmitted from parent to child and how that determines what happens to the child. Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
I was just thinking that it seems to me, I know for myself and it seems like the people around me, sometimes it's hard to actually recognize what your addictions are because some of them aren't like the glaringly obvious addictions like substances and food. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the other kinds of addictions that you have which are not as obvious, because it seems like you have to know what your addictions are first.
Well, can I say that that knowledge is about a desire to step out of denial. When you want to see, you'll begin to see. And that's an emotional place that you reach. So many, and this is another way I feel many people engage their intellect with the teaching and not their heart. They think, okay, I hear what they're saying about addiction. What could mine be? But there's no actual heart desire to know what they are. And that's so there's a process of developing desire that must happen within you. Because believe me, they become more and more glaringly obvious the more you want that. And God is showing you, like literally in every moment of every day, His desire is that we see it, that we know ourselves, and that He knows that's the start. That's how we start to know ourselves, is by seeing how we're avoiding ourselves through addiction. So I feel the real answer is actually about developing desire. I could list lots, and I listed a few yesterday, just emotional addictions, but they play out in relationships in like many, many different ways. For yourself, Liz, there's lots of feelings about wanting to have control with men, for example, and having a sense of needing to have a sense of yourself through your mediumship. So there's many things there that, but at the moment you're intellectually saying, maybe I can see some of that, but your heart is still possibly in the place that Francine's talking about of how am I going to judge myself if I actually realize these things emotionally about myself? Yeah. Would you add to that, babe?
Yeah, the importance of desire, can't be underestimated. The instant you have a pure desire to know an addiction will be the instant that God shows you the addiction. It's quite simple. God always answers prayers, and prayers are always based on pure desire. Mm-hmm. So we can say, I want to know what my addictions are, while at exactly the same time saying, in our soul going, oh, I don't want to know what my addictions are. I want them all met. I want them all. You know, I want them all to be satisfied. That's what I really want. You know, and even the honesty of I want them all satisfied would be better than going, I really want to know what my addictions are. When you have that time of a pure desire, remember, and particularly if you direct that to God, that's now a prayer. And if it's pure, it will always be answered instantly. So if you're praying to God to help you expose your addictions, and in the course of the day, no addictions get exposed to you, then that is an indication that you are not being sincere in your prayer with God. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And many, many times, like some of the hardest thing for me to realize has been, wow, every time in the past when I felt good, that was actually me in an addiction. Right. You know? So there was a lot of pain in recognizing, wow, I'm going to have to give up all these times when I actually feel safe, liked, secure, loved, all those things. But during that process, during that kind of realizing and desiring to actually see, because your soul is becoming more sensitive, we are becoming more sensitive to what's really going on inside of us, it also begins to feel a bit icky. When you've then engaged with someone in what is actually an addiction, as you're just waking up to this process, you walk away feeling like, yeah, it doesn't feel so good anymore. I feel like we just sort of stroked each other's egos maybe, but it doesn't feel like we had a heart connection. It doesn't feel like I was even myself then. And it starts to feel, that's the sensitivity growing. That's how you know your desire is growing to actually see these things, because you begin to feel in day-to-day life, oh, yeah, that would have made me feel really good in the past, but now I feel a bit like something's off, you know. What was that? What is really going on in that relationship with that person? That kind of thing.
Yeah. Thank you.
No worries.
It's helpful.
Yeah. Marina, did you want to... If you just pass forward to Marina and take the other mic up the back, yeah. Yeah.
Thanks, guys, with the mics.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
And this is in a question to what you said about after dinner, about the spirits projecting angrily at you.
Mm-hmm.
What benefit do they feel they receive by having us stay in addictions? I've understood what you've mentioned in regards to spirits prompting relationships, because they get that feed. But and you know, when it comes to alcohol and drugs, yeah, that's my question.
You want to answer that? Or?
Yeah, well, I think a few of the things that you've just mentioned are quite important. So many spirits like people to remain in a state of denial and addiction so that they can actually continue to meet their addictions and remain in denial of their own soul themselves, even though they've now passed. They still don't have this heart desire that I was talking to Liz about to actually see and know themselves. So when you're engaged in a situation with a group of men, and you are in an addiction where you get to feel attractive or powerful or whatever, a whole bunch of other women can be with you going, yeah, this feels good. I like what she's doing here. Continue there, Marina. That's, you know, because they're in the same addiction. Even just because they've lost their physical body doesn't mean they've actually wanted to step down in this process. So they're going to also, if two people meet and it looks like maybe we can manipulate their addictions to have them have a sexual relationship, that kind of feels nice if I get to be present during that and I'm a spirit. I get to feel things that due to my current position in the spirit world, I can't engage in anymore. So let's keep them in their addictions, keep them doing those things. That's kind of a minute thing. It actually gets far more sinister if you take it out even further when you start to talk about whole countries and wars and economic systems. Mm. There's a lot of people in the spirit world who are still very addicted to a sense of power, a sense of domination over others, and they're very involved in manipulating things that happen on a global level to feed those addictions inside of themselves. Mm. Yeah, so there's a lot.
Can I also mention codependence? Like, what most people don't realise is that the only people they attract are the people who are willing to be in codependence with them about addiction. So oftentimes we can go, when we're in denial of our addictions, almost our entire life is about codependencies. So we end up attracting another person into our life who's the exact mirror or sympathetic to our addiction. So in other words, they will give me, Mary gives me the addiction I want, and I'm willing to give her the addiction she wants. Both of us want to be in denial that we even have an addiction, and we're going to feel fantastic in the relationship then, right? But unfortunately, we'll be not loving to ourselves, we'll be not loving the other person, and we'll never reach at one with God ever if we stay in that place. So this is where we need to get out of codependency. So the only person you will attract right at this point, whether it's a spirit or another man, is a man. So it will be men who meet your addictions or women who are sympathetic to your addictions. They're the only ones you'll finish up attracting while you desire to remain in denial. As soon as you have a desire to see the addiction exposed, you will instantly attract a man who doesn't meet your addiction and women who do not sympathise with your addiction. Does that make sense? So the women who do not sympathise with your addiction will tell you, Marina, you've got this addiction. And you go, I don't want to know that. But once you've shifted from this denial to a desire, you'll start going, this is an indication to me that now women are not agreeing with me. So all of my friends before then agreed with me and they all had the same addiction. Now I've got one woman in my life coming up to me who doesn't have that same addiction. She's pointing it out to me. This is the start of awareness. And then a man might come up and say, Marina, the feeling I get from you is really harsh with men. You know, like it feels terrible being around you. I don't find you any attractive at all. You know, and that will cause you to go, oh, here's a man who's not meeting my addictions. This is interesting. He's now reflecting a different thing to me, and this is an indication that I'm now getting out of. My soul is now shifting out of denial and into desire to know. And that's a very, very powerful thing. So if you are finding that your friends around you all are supportive of you, they're supportive of what you believe and how you feel about yourself and all those other things, then it's highly likely, if you're not at one with God, it's highly likely that they're supporting your addictions and therefore in a codependent relationship with you. If you find that the people around you are now confronting you with all sorts of things coming up, now it demonstrates you're in a desire to know and you're now moving away from codependency into some kind of acceptance that I've got to work on these particular issues that are being exposed to me. And that's the beauty of this great law of attraction God's made, is that when we have a pure desire to know, we will know. And usually that'll be instant, by the way. You'll have an attraction event that occurs, as you experienced yesterday, of triggering a particular thing immediately, demonstrating the addiction still exists. And
if we can explain that. Marina came and asked me after the talk yesterday about a specific issue that she didn't understand, something that was happening in her life. And I said, why don't you just pray for God to show you what it's really about and just be on the lookout? And how long did it take?
About 15 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what happened?
I had asked something about Mary, about this fear that I constantly feel in my stomach, this activation, this area that feels like a vortex of energy going out and in, and just always feeling afraid all the time. Mm-hmm. And Mary told me that it has to do with sexual terror. Mm-hmm. And so I went away, and I guess sometimes I don't make a point like, God, I'm going to pray to you. I guess internally I'm praying to God to feel what's going on, you know, that sort of thing. And I went to the pool to go to the hot tub at the Bally's next door. And as I went to the area, there was a man who was masturbating in the hot tub to young children in the pool, little girls. Mm. Yeah. Feel a lot of anger.
Exactly. There's the anger, the covering over of the addiction. Yeah.
Of the, anyway, so I went back. And I expressed the feeling of anger towards that man who was doing it. And I ended up remembering an occurrence that happened to me, that someone, I was playing in the park. I don't remember it vividly, but something. And there was a man who was doing the same thing to myself and other children.
Yeah. And that's what I said to Marina. I said, it feels like sexual terror, but there's something specific. And just ask God to show you what was specific.
And when you told me, I was like, there's no way that I'm going to find out right now. And it was true.
Yeah.
Yeah. 15 minutes later, an event involving lots of people.
Maybe 20 or something, but
And that's the power of a desire. The power of a desire is that once you get out of the denial and you have a desire to know, even desire to know what you're denying, immediately events get created. Your soul immediately creates events through this law of attraction that expose to it, to your soul, what's the problem and what the actual unemotion that was that you were just talking about. You know, that's the beauty of the process. And this is also the beauty of involving God. Because, you know, God's got far more control over the universe than you guys really recognize at this point in time. Does that make sense? We constantly feel like, oh, the universe is some kind of anarchy, that God's just sitting up there, you know, in some kind of throne is the general, you know, so he's sitting on his throne looking down at the universe and going, yeah, all this stuff's going on, and I'm just observing. And God is not a passive observer of his own universes. He's directly involved within your life as soon as you want him to be. As soon as you want him to be. So if you desperately want him to show you the addictions that prevent you from being happy, prevent you from connecting to God, prevent you from connecting to relationship to a partner, then he'll show you if there's the desire. And that's why I said in the first century consistently that this underlying pure desire, this underlying desire to know, was the key part of your development in terms of your life. And you know, that's why I said the words, keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. Because if you develop this pure desire through that process, God will tell you instantly, generally. God will tell you, but certainly within the same day, generally, God will tell you exactly what is going on for you and why it's going on as well.
Yeah. I just want to say quickly about how you mentioned the getting out of from denial to desire. Mm-hmm. I realize in myself how much I want to know. It's like, so what do we need to do to know how to get from there to there? And in my experience, just based on the brief rapport I had with you, that very often for me, I don't know if it helps other people, sometimes it feels so overwhelming that I just leave it to God because there's nobody else. Mm-hmm. And sometimes in that itself is like super powerful, because that's when the truth comes out.
Exactly.
Yeah. And the overwhelm, that's the thing that when AJ hits you with all the truth and you go, whoa, that's overwhelming, is to embrace that overwhelm and go, whoa, because that truth enters. Truth can enter when you let yourself be overwhelmed. If you're just trying to, like, I'll have a little bit, not too much, or on my own terms, God, God's like, well, I'm really big and you're really small, and how am I going to... You're going to have to let yourself be overwhelmed for me to tell you something. Yeah, so, yeah. Someone had their hand up at the back, yeah?
I know I spoke to you about this yesterday at dinner. The question I have... This is exhausting.
That's because you're not letting yourself be overwhelmed.
That why? That's
because you... Yeah.
Okay.
The reason why we get exhausted is because we don't allow ourselves to be overwhelmed. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm allowing it.
Yeah.
I'm right here. When I really believe that I'm like I'm in the muck, I'm working on it. Like I'm in the darkest, and I've gone through this many times. You know, working it through, going through. I think what I believe I'm doing all that, and the result sometimes is obvious that I've really done it because everything changes immediately, but a lot of times it doesn't, and I go like, what could I have possibly missed? I can't go any other dark, deep, mucky place. I'm still in that. You know, like, I don't know if I'm explaining that right.
You are.
I feel
stuck. And what did I tell you last night? What did I say last night?
Yeah, I know. That there's something else that I'm missing.
And you don't want to know.
And you don't have the desire to know.
I hear that. But I don't feel that.
Can I point out to you, though, that the law of attraction is perfect? So if your life has changed through an experience you've just had, then it will automatically reflect back at you that you've changed. Yeah. If nothing's changed and it's reflecting back at you that nothing's changed or very little has changed, then it means that you're not actually in the actual emotional cause as to why, you know, this particular event occurred. What I see a lot of people doing is they choose to have a certain type of emotion because the real emotion is too unpleasant for them to even consider to feel. And this is the problem you face.
Totally. And there's so much judgment we have. This thing that Francine brought up about judgment, you know, we judge and look, I've been everywhere, God. I've been in the dark corners of my soul. And this is another arrogance that we have. We're wandering around in a lot of denial and addiction, but we think we know ourselves better than God. No, God, I know everything that's in me. I've just been to all of it. And God's actually showing us through the law of attraction, as AJ says, sorry, sister, you don't know all of everything that's inside of you yet. And at the moment, you still don't want to know. That's why you feel like, no, I've cleaned out all the closets, yeah. You know.
And we find this happens very regularly where people come up to us and say, look, I've cried about this over and over again, but nothing's changed. And I'm saying, well, if nothing's changed, then the law of attraction, God's laws are all perfect, and you need to make the assumption that God's laws are all perfect. So if something had actually changed in your soul through all that crying, your life would have changed. So the reality is all that crying was probably an addiction, was all probably related to an addiction. Because if it wasn't related to an addiction, but rather was related to a causal emotion, your life would have instantly have reflected the change. And many people are not trusting that. They don't trust that. So what they do is, oh, I'm trying to get this. And then they even want to have this arrogant position of going, I've done the work. God should change the universe.
Doesn't he know I did
Doesn't
that?
Doesn't he know I've done the work? You know, there's that kind of attitude almost to God. And God's going, sorry, sister. I give perfectly everything. That means that if there is a sincere change in you, then I will demonstrate to you that change. All of my laws will demonstrate to you that change. So if the change hasn't occurred, the person you need to look at is yourself, no one else. And you need to first assume that you must be in great denial of the particular thing. If you can't see it, you're obviously in denial. Does that make sense? So then you would have to ask yourself, okay, why am I in so much denial? There's got to be an issue here that I'm in so much denial of that I don't even want to know or have a desire to know what it is. So the law of attraction is demonstrating to you through these events that you are in this great denial of something. And if you really set your intention with God to know what that thing is, and you have a sincere desire to know what that thing is, then God will demonstrate it to you, just as it as God did yesterday to Marina about that particular problem that she was facing. And that's exactly what happens every time. So if that's not happening every time, the first place we need to go to is, okay, I must be in denial again about another thing. I must be in denial about another thing. I must be in my addictions with this thing as well. If to maintain my denial, it has to be true. So that's where we need to go. Rather than tell ourselves the mistake lies with God or the mistake lies with God's laws. And this is what I see a lot of people telling themselves. They sort of, they have this arrogant thing going on with God. I've cried about that enough now. You should have changed something. And God's not going to change anything for us. Because the soul, when the soul changes, everything around us automatically changes. And God's laws are all perfect. God doesn't need to change something for us because all of God's laws are reflecting perfectly what is actually happening. So it's very important for every single person who is still attracting the same kind of events to realize that there must be high levels of denial. Even when they're crying, there must be high levels of denial. There's got to be a lot of addiction in their crying for them to be crying tears and at the same time nothing changing. So there's got to be a huge amount of denial in those tears for them to actually be working. And what we've both found, myself and Mary have found, is that we often prefer tears of hurt and addiction than we do going to the terror that covers the tears of grief. Right? Yeah. Do you understand what I meant by that? So we often prefer the tears associated with not having our addictions met than we do the experiencing the terror that we need to go through in order to feel our real grief. And this is where most people come to grief in their processing work. So they think they're processing, but they're often not processing at all, or they're processing the emotions of spirits who are with them in preference to feeling their own terrors.
Yeah, and something I see a lot of people doing is being confronted by an addiction not being met, then crying, which is actually tears of, I can't get what I want. But because our intellect is so fancy and strong, we go, oh no, this is actually hurt about my dad. This man hasn't treated me in the way that I want. That's because my dad was, you know, he wasn't there for me in the way that I want. And we're actually, we're crying tears, which are really, I can't get what I want. And I want this man to treat me in the way that I want. They're actually hurt, angry tears. But we can, because we're clever, we go, we attach it to something that we know would be a healing grief. Dad ignored me. Dad, you know, and we can do that over and over and over. And I hear people go, I've been crying about my dad ignoring me for 6 months and this man's still ignoring me. And very often it's because we're not being real with ourselves about the addiction. And this is what I'm trying to stress today. You've got to get real about the addiction. It's okay to have a cry and go, I want him to give me what I want. But we're going to have to face the truth that, okay, this is exposing in me an unloving demand that I have. There's an unloving expectation.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you're crying for 6 months about a man ignoring you, of course he's going to continue ignoring you. Because the reality is you have a demand in you that is trying to support the addiction you have, that he doesn't ignore you. And while you're crying about him not ignoring you, you're not actually ever getting to the real causes to why you feel so bad when he ignores you. Does that make sense? He's allowed to ignore you. He's got free will. He's allowed to completely ignore you for the rest of your life. You know, I see this happening with many people. We often get emails from people about their soulmates. You know, they say, I know who my soulmate is now, and he's ignoring me. I've told him he's unloving, and I told him he's being unloving to me now, and he's being unloving to our soul. And I often cry about it, and I've been crying about it for many months, and nothing's changing. It's just getting worse. That's what they say. It's just getting worse. It's getting so bad now that he told me he never wants to hear from me ever again. And I sort of feel like, yeah, I don't blame him actually. right? The poor guy, he's got all this demand coming at him, and the person who's crying about the response is not being honest. That there's all this demand coming out of her towards him. And what is this demand all about? This demand is about addictions she once met. It's got nothing to do with any causal emotion. So she can be crying and crying, all this so-called sadness, but it's not really sadness. It's just rage in a different form, right? And she cries it out, and never lets it go. And of course, she never will find what is actually going on. And also, by the way, it's highly unlikely the person she thinks is a soulmate is actually a soulmate under these circumstances, because she has such a huge addiction that she's willing to cry about it for months not getting met without even being sincere with herself about the fact that it must feel terrible on the guy's end, feeling all of this crap coming at him, feeling all of this demand and, you know, desire for attention and approval coming at him that he's got to meet. And he's got a role before he even begins a relationship. And wouldn't you run away from such a person? Of course you would. And so, you know, the law of attraction is perfect in that circumstance too. It's perfect. It's showing the woman that actually she is being totally dishonest with herself. If this man was truly her soulmate and she was truly processing through causal emotion related to her to soulmate related issues and grief and with her father, and she was truly feeling, you know, in a place of softness about all of those emotions, her life would change tomorrow, today even. You know, every single time I processed an emotion that I knew was a healing emotion, when Mary was not with me, she would contact me within a day, within one day. And she would contact me and want to... Yeah. And there's been quite a number of times when Mary left my life over a period of nearly a year and a half, right? And some of it for extended periods, right? 3 months at a time. And as soon as I processed through one of those emotions, I didn't ring her, I didn't badger her, I didn't pester her, I didn't email her, I didn't... you know, browbeat her into submission or any of those particular things. All I did was process the causal emotion related to how I felt. And I often even knew that's the one. Like, sometimes I've been crying for weeks and weeks and weeks, and then once I got to the one, you know, bang, that's the one, she'll call me. And sure enough, day later, next morning, pick up the phone. Oh, Mary, yes, sort of expecting your call. And the reason why is because God's law is perfect. God's law of attraction is perfect. If you address the real thing inside of you, there will always be a change that will happen very rapidly as a result in your life, as a result of addressing the change.
And so if it's not happening... okay, I've got to ask for more truth. I've got to be willing to be more humble. I've got to be willing to see, I don't actually want to know what it's really about yet. And just be real about that until I get real about wanting to know what it's about, you know?
Yeah. Just be real too about the fact that you want God to change the laws for you, you know? Like, you want God to manipulate this person into loving you or whatever it is that you're crying about. You know, allow yourself to feel that. And then also allow yourself to ponder about, like, what would you do if you were God under those circumstances? You know, allow yourself to have a very open feelings and dialogues with God about the particular emotions that exist in you. The beauty of doing that is that you will remain very conscious of all of the things that you're in addiction with. And you'll find in the end that there'll be very little denial going on in your life, if anything at all. In fact, if you do that. Mm. And if you also trust God, trust that God's laws are perfect. If change is not happening in my life, then it's because I am not changing. It's not because of anyone else around me. I'll say that again. If change is not happening in my life, it's because I am not changing. Right? And it doesn't matter how much crying you're doing or how much other feelings you're having, if change is not happening in your life, then you are not really changing. You'd be better off not doing it, wouldn't you? Mm. Or you'd be better off looking at, okay, if I'm crying and I feel the need to cry and yet nothing's changing, then it must be an addiction. It's got to be something that I want here that I'm not getting. Yeah. And if you can trust that, then you'll never go down the track of saying, what's wrong with God? I've cried about this so many times. What's wrong with you? Like, why isn't my life changing? Because you'll always see that the only reason why your life's not changing is because of something that you're choosing. And once I've come to terms with that myself, and Mary took a while to come to terms with that yourself too, haven't you? Like in the process, once you come to terms with that, it's just amazing because you have a lot more power over your life once you realise that. You start crying and then nothing changes within a day. Then you go, well, that was useless. Obviously, I was crying about the wrong thing and it's pointless doing that. Like, why would I do that again or again or again or again, another day, another day, another day? I've got to go deeper and find out what am I in denial of. So that my prayer to God then will become, like, if I've cried and I feel like it's a deep gut-wrenching cry and then the exact same situation that I cried about hasn't changed immediately, like within the next day or so, then I've got to go, okay, well, I mustn't have cried about the actual thing. And if I haven't cried about the actual thing, then my crying must have been addictive. It must be related to my addictions not being met. And then I could go, okay, God, show me what I'm in denial of here, instead of going, oh, I'll cry again and hopefully I'll get a different result this time. And what's the definition of stupidity again? Doing the same thing over and over again, hoping for a different result. All we're doing there is being quite stupid. Does that make sense? And if we can, instead of doing that, go, okay, I've cried about this two times now and still nothing's really changed. I'm obviously like right off the ballpark here with regard to what I'm crying about, and I'm probably in an addiction of some kind, and I need to look at what I'm in denial of, because obviously once I can address that, then I'll be able to expose what's the actual problem here. So what I found personally too is that I have cried about things that later I've realised that my whole reason for crying was all about a demand I had.
And that's what I would like to mention, that I feel one of the biggest addictions that exist on the planet is the demand to be loved. And this feeling that we know what it is to be loved and a demand that we be treated in that way. I see a lot of people avoiding a lot of fear and pain crying about that one thing.
Because the reality is that nobody has to love you. Nobody. And it's not even a right you have. Being loved is not a right. Do you understand that? See, most people don't understand that here in their soul. They believe being loved is a right. It's not a right. Being loved is a gift. And if you believe being loved is a right, you have a lot of emotional injury already to work your way through.
And a lot of demand coming out of you to your environment.
Yeah.
And also the other thing is we believe we know what being loved looks like. And for most of us, we have no idea what it actually means to be really loved. Mm. And so we feel that if you love me, you meet my addictions. That's the unwritten feeling that's coming out of us most of the time. And when someone doesn't meet my addictions, they're not loving me. And I should be able to be loved. I know what love is and I've got a right to be loved. Mm. And that can get very circular in terms of processing. It's not even true. Processing.
Yeah. I remember in my own progression, most of the feelings I had to get rid of were related to what I felt were rights that in the end were just, I was just way off being with love. Like, and I had to come to an understanding that these weren't rights, but rather potential gifts. Mm. And that I could not demand gifts from people, including gifts of love from people. Like, I could not demand that somebody loves me just because I loved them, for example. I could not demand that somebody cared for me just because I cared for them. And once you work your way through all of that emotionally, you finish up, like, most of your crying stops being addictive in its nature. So I went through a whole period of time where my tears were all addictive, or mostly addictive in nature. I went through, I think I've described before in some videos, but I went through a period where none of my family would speak to me, none of my friends would speak to me. I didn't have any job at all. I lived alone and my children wouldn't even speak to me and I was just alone, right? And I cried about that for a while and then I realised I wanted all them people that loved me. And it was my addiction that was the reason why I was crying. So what I had to do was just cry about the fact that nobody loved me, but I had to get deeper into that and also cry about the fact that I didn't understand what love was. And through that process of releasing that, I came to understand that I could love people even if nobody loved me. And that there was one being who did love me, and that was God. And if I connected to God, I would always feel loved no matter what anybody else felt about me. And that's how I can love other people who don't love me. Right? And but I had to give up all of my addictions about what I wanted my friends to do, and what I wanted my family to do, and what I wanted my children to do, and what I wanted from a partner, and all those things I had to give up.
And very much the same for me surrounding love. But also, I remember the day you said to me, "There are no safe places, Mary." That's an addiction, to need a safe place, to need to feel safe. And that was very, like, that's a whole other set of processing that I'm having to go through about feeling like I should be able to feel safe. And the fact that I want my environment to make me feel safe. Yeah.
Which is just another sort of demand. So it's a similar demand to the demand to be loved, demand to be safe. But you see, we have so many of these things that we feel justified creating. We call them rights. That's what we call them. I have a right to be safe, a right to be fed, a right to be this, a right to be that, and a right. And in a Western society, our right list, you know, not the right list on the right, but the list of things that we feel are rights that we have is quite long.
Yeah. And if we compare rights, if we say that rights actually equal demands,
which they are,
and if we recognize that demands are actually an angry thing, we see where these things fit in the chain of emotional development. Rights are created, they're actually demands that are angry, that are actually created when we don't feel, to avoid our terror that our addiction won't be met. The truth is, we will feel loved and we will feel safe once we pass through those emotional stages. Mm. But we create rights as demands to avoid that whole process.
So none of you have the right to be loved. None of you have the right to be safe. None of you. The irony is, once you release the demand, which you believe is a right, that for the first time in your life, you'll actually be safe. And for the first time in your life, you'll actually feel loved. And you won't actually need another person to love you. And it's a wonderful thing. Because your entire life then becomes independent of every other being who's ever existed. Because when you no longer need another person to love you, and you know that it's only between this love that you're receiving from God is the thing that will sustain the rest of your existence. Once you understand that, you won't have a demand come out of you towards another person to treat you in any way. And in that moment, you will be able to be the most loving person you could ever be. You'll be able to actually act in harmony with love every single time with every single person, no matter how bad they are or how good they are. In addition, when your mate comes along and you attract your soulmate into your life, they won't have a role. They won't have a task. You won't be putting upon them a demand and saying, "You have to do this for me." Does that make sense? You won't be putting upon them any demands. So, of course, how loved do you think they are going to feel if you don't put any demands on them at all, but you still love them? They're going to feel quite loved, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
And how attracted would you be to that if that was you? Of course you'd be very attracted to that, wouldn't you? You'd be so attracted to it that you'd want to do the same thing, surely, in the long run. And you'd want to know how they did that, how they come to this amazing state of love that you feel all the time from them, because they just don't have any demands upon you anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Like, imagine that. And this is where we need to understand the truth about love. Like, and we don't, you know. And the reason why we don't is because we believe love is a right, and when that, of course, hooks into addictions. And so really what we are with love is we have this long list of addictions associated with love that we have to release if we're ever going to be at one with God. And they are in us. they didn't get in us through our own fault, but they are now in us, and the only person that can release them is ourselves. Nobody else can do it for us. Even God can't do it for us. He can help us, but he can't do it. We have to be willing to do it ourselves.
Boris, have you
heard that? Well, I just want to mention what I feel has helped me a lot is the fact of staying vulnerable. And staying vulnerable keeps you in a childlike state.
Yeah.
Because everything that blocks us is when we start to demand control. And a lot of things on the path will actually, when we think this is something that I need to clear, we'll approach it from an adult state instead of from a childlike state. So by being vulnerable and not trying to identify every little thing, mm-hmm. we'll actually start to feel it. And as we feel it, we'll know exactly what to release.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Very good comment.
Yeah, very good comment. Yeah. Can we also expand on the word vulnerable and maybe call it open and without facade?
Yeah.
Because often vulnerable is something we associate with danger or fear.
Sure.
And actually being open and humble and without facade, that's actually a really powerful place. Mm. But we commonly call it vulnerability because we have a lot of false beliefs about it. Yeah. Right.
That's what I mean. Like I actually feel like a child.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's as soon as I started feeling like a child, it's like it was like a permission slip to feel like a child again.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I have another question, if I may. If you're progressing like together, I'm very lucky to be with somebody who's also on the path. And
yeah.
And but a lot of times we get into this trouble of helping each other, and in the loving way. So like I know that I can mention like okay, this is your law of attraction, and all the time. What would be like a good way to help each other in a loving way without you know, expressing too many demands or, you know, trying to understand that it's not that your addiction is to tell her, because then you're shifting responsibility and things like that.
It's a very good question. Usually when we have to tell the other person something, there's one of two different things going on generally. The first thing is that we want the other person to change before we change.
Or before we feel. Yeah.
So in other words, if let's say Mary does something, like she might, I don't know, just as an idea, Mary might decide that Michael's a very attractive man and she projects sexually, there you go, Mike, and she projects sexually at Mike, and I notice that. So, and I go, oh, that was a bit off, you know, because I would like, of course, and if she's my soulmate, I'll feel it instantly, generally. But I would like her to only be sexually attracted to myself, right? That's the underlying demand or the underlying addiction that I have. And so instead of feeling that, what I go is, oh, Mary, did you just notice what you did there? Did you notice what the law of attraction was doing there? And did you notice that you just gave Michael a sexual feeling and how he responded to that? And so now I'm involved in helping her. Right, but what's my motive for helping her? It is questionable, isn't it? Because my motive for helping her is really to stop myself from feeling some pain, so that I don't feel jealous or some other emotion. Whereas what I need to do first is I need to go, okay, what's my response here? Now my response might be like jealousy, or I might feel initially some anger that she's not attracted to me anymore in that moment, or whatever. And I need to allow myself to feel that, and I need to allow myself to go through that and even get to closer to why I feel so triggered by that, and allow myself to even feel some grief about that if I can. But at least be honest and open enough to see that, yeah, this is obviously an event that still affects me. Now, it's still right, of course, to raise the issue with my partner if she doesn't observe it. But you have to ask first whether she wants to know.
Sure.
Wouldn't you? Like, you'd have to. Do you want to know what happened there between yourself and Michael? And Mary might go, no, nothing happened. You know, like, and then I'd have to feel her desire to not even know, as well as another emotion that I need to firstly process. Now, of course, if Mary consistently is projecting sexually to other men, then I would have to have a response to that, in the sense of it's not loving to herself to do that, it's not loving to the other men, it's also not loving to our relationship or myself. And so I'd have to go, hang on a sec, darling, I've seen you do this a number of times now, and the reality is you want to stay in complete denial of it, but there also the reality is that that it means that you're not attracted to me in that moment. And to be frank with you, I can't engage in a relationship with you if you're not attracted to me. So because that's an issue of my love of myself. And so you would address the issue, and then hopefully the partner would want to look at the issue. But if they don't, then you might separate for a while even and wait for them to come to their own realizations about the issue.
What if the partner's not being loving to herself? And
well, she still doesn't want to see that.
Right.
Yeah. So there are many times when one or both of us haven't wanted to see that we're being unloving to ourselves. It happens with me frequently with groups, like in the sense that I give a lot in terms of question and answers and so forth. And sometimes we miss out on having our life as a result of that. And so Mary points it out to me and says, you gave too much again, like what's going on, you know? And that's fantastic to be able to have somebody do that.
Yeah.
But not in an addictive manner.
Yeah.
Not doing it because they feel jealous or they feel, you know, because there's issues there if they do that. Yeah.
And if you can, something I notice couples do, or there's a tendency or there's a danger of doing, is just using language of the past to cover over emotional conflict, actually, demands or expectations on each other, but by saying, this is a love of self issue, or that's your law of attraction, or
you'd
whatever.
You'd be better off actually going, I'm really angry. Yeah. Like, wouldn't you? Yeah. Rather than going, this is your law of attraction, you just did this or did that. You'd be better off going, because that's the feeling that's coming inside of you, so you'd better off going, I'm really angry, I feel really hurt that you did such and such. I feel really hurt. And then start to realize why you feel hurt. Like, you know, but you can, even if the other person's open, you can describe why you feel hurt. And quite often during the description of why you feel so hurt, you'll actually get to the actual emotion and have a big cry about it. And it's great when you can have a relationship like that, because it means that you can actually have every emotion in front of the other person without them condemning it, judging it, criticizing you for it, reacting to it.
Or trying to intervene.
You know? And it's fantastic. Yeah. It's a fantastic power if your mate can do that for you and you can do that for your mate. So that's what we do for each other. Does that make sense? We allow ourselves to feel the emotion rather than just go, oh, you've got a law of attraction event there or whatever. Yeah. You know, and that's often a very passive-aggressive way to have a relationship. Yeah.
And I often say to couples, like, it's like when I meet them, they're on opposite sides of a fence, and they're fighting each other over this fence. And for me, something happened somewhere in our relationship where we both ended up on the same side of the fence. And it was going down a road that leads to God. And there was an acknowledgement in both of us that we both still have emotional issues. So I acknowledge that I have emotional errors in me, and that AJ also has emotional injuries in him. Mm-hmm. And he acknowledged the same thing, that he has them and he can see them in me. But it wasn't. Whereas before I would take everything as a criticism, or I'd want to defend.
It wasn't like picking on each other.
You know, it was just a loving now relationship where we both recognise those truths. We both recognise we want to go for God. And on that journey, there's going to be issues that come up. If we can lovingly go, well, we both want the same thing. We both want growth. We both want God. So it's actually a gifting process now to allow each other to have their emotion, to hear from the other. And it wasn't like a competition anymore. Mm. Yeah.
And it's even better when you know your soulmates, because it's sort of like you're one soul. So any progress Mary makes benefits our complete soul.
Yeah.
And any progress I make benefits our complete soul. So when Mary points something out to me, I don't go, you know.
You're picking on me.
Like, she's pointing out something to our soul. Do you see what I'm saying? And the way I think about it, well, yeah, that's an important issue we've got to address in our soul. Like, and if it's the emotion inside of me that's affecting our soul, then I want to address it. I want to actually look at what's going on and find the answers to what's going on sincerely. Because if you look at that, if Mary can see something, and often can, you know, if somebody, the person with you, can often see things you can't see. So if Mary can see something that I can't see, and I can see something that Mary can't see, and we're both in an open place with each other where we don't feel attacked or criticized in what we see in each other, but rather we want to know what the other person sees, then can you see that the benefits of that to our complete soul are going to be so great that we're going to be able to just be freely open with what we see, each of us, and then in the end we'll be able to work our way through that emotionally. We're not attacking each other. It's not counterproductive. We feel like we're growing together and we're getting closer and closer together as a result. And in the end, anything Mary says to me, instead of feeling like, oh, that was an attack and that was another disapproval and that was another thing, that it feels like, no, Mary's desire in her, which I can feel now, is this desire that we progress. At the start of our relationship, Mary's desire was quite different. It was desire to attack, pull me down, turn me into something she wanted me to be, which is very, very different.
And maintain a facade even to myself. And that's something probably that I wanted to say to everyone around the issue of what we're talking about today, denial, addiction and judgment of self. The biggest thing that happened for me, for us to both get on the same side of the fence, was to give up this sense of judging myself. Because every time AJ would say something to me, I would judge myself. And in the beginning, I'd perceive he was even judging me. And that gets tiring and horrible, and you don't actually want to be in that place. And so that's a big block that Francine pointed out before to recognizing your addictions, is this judgment of self thing that happens. Something really crucial that I worked through around that, in addition to what AJ talked about before, it was facing a fear. And the fear was, I remember we were lying in bed one night and I just said to him, you know what my biggest fear is that underneath all of this, I'm just actually a bad person. That I'm gonna try and heal, and I'm gonna discover actually I am bad, I am flawed, and that I can't actually heal it. It's just me. Now that sounds simple, but it was massive for me. And that's when he said the beautiful words.
And can I point out too that Mary felt that emotion?
Yes.
Like she actually cried and sobbed about the fact that she felt that inside of her she was just flawed. And she just let herself feel that that's the truth. She let herself feel that.
Yeah. So I cryingly told you that and cried about it. And AJ said to me that beautiful thing that he said to you before, which is, darling, I'm not worried because I know God only makes beautiful things. Now, that one truth, if you can face that fear and like feel that fear and let God give you that one truth, that underneath it all, you are beautiful, then that is like such a huge gift to me. It's like I was writing in my journal the other day, it's like a precious stone I carry in my pocket. And I take it out sometimes and I look at it because it helps me remember, yes, God made me something beautiful. Even if I don't feel it now, even if I'm terrified of facing this thing about me that's in me now, I know that God created me beautiful. And if you can let that truth enter your heart, you can go a long way. That gives you a lot of courage and a lot of faith in facing yourself in these early stages where it feels quite icky, you know, why am I red? Do I really do that? Do I really want that? Am I really like that? You know, that's what it feels like some days.
And you'll be open to the truth.
Yeah.
About yourself.
Because you'll realize it's just an injury in me. It's not who I am. And we're so used to in our society believing what we are now is who we are. And that's why we try to create these big facades of I'm someone wonderful, I'm someone capable, I'm someone beautiful, I'm someone, all these things, because everyone judges us. That's who we are. Whatever we present, that's it. Not we're a work in progress, not we're someone growing, not we're someone who can develop. That's who we are. And it's not the truth. And so if you can let that truth about that how God created you, not the truth you've created about yourself, if you can let the truth that you are a beautiful creation of God, that's in one of the first lines of the prayer for divine love. If that can enter your heart, that can take you such a long way. Mm. So to...
Jean, did you have a question?
Yeah, my comments, it's a long route. Not just you have to first identify your addictions, you also have to identify your denial, which is even harder.
Yeah.
And once you've done that, you've got to also identify the right emotion. And sometimes with the denial, you're not on the right emotion.
Yeah.
And you got to go there to find out. And you may try 10 times and never succeed and finally went into that like that. And you see the comments I had with the comments he made and the reaction and the example you did about being attracted, and then you felt that it's not loving for her not to attract my soul. But at the same time, I can have the reaction, well, now I don't even have the right to ask my soulmate to be attracted by me because this is the demand. And normally I should not be in the demand for that. I should. Mm.
Yep.
It's also an addiction.
You just hold the mic a bit closer.
Yeah. Have this.
That's it.
Yes.
So it's quite a complex process.
Can I point out though, Joanne, that it's a complex process if we do it without God. But if you do it with God, it's a very simple process actually, because God presents you the very next thing you need to do through the law of attraction. And so you don't even have to think so much about this. Mm. You just have to be aware that denial exists inside of you and aware that addictions exist. And all we need to do is ask God for the next thing. And this is the difference between doing it with God and doing it ourselves. Many of us want to do it ourselves because we don't really have a connection with God or don't have a strong desire for God or any of those kind of things. And as a result of that, we finish up not doing it with God. We finish up doing it for ourselves. Does that make sense?
Do it with your heart, not your head. Yeah.
Well, you've got to do both, don't you? You've got to do it with your heart and do it with God. And if you do it with God and with your heart, and this is the heart. I feel that's the only hard thing, because doing it with your heart involves you being sincere and really truthful with yourself about it. But if you do it with God and really have a sincere desire to do it with God, God will always show you the next thing. In the first century, I said quite frequently that God does not give you a serpent when you ask for some food. In other words, God does not give you something bad when you ask for something good. And this is where most of us still have this sort of mistrust of God or self-reliance is still kicking in. And I feel while we're self-reliant, we have to go through this whole thing of working and all that, and it becomes very complex, very difficult. And to be frank, if I had to do it that way, I would probably have given up a long time ago, to be honest. But all I've found is all I need to do is trust the very next thing. So all I've had to do is go, okay, God is good. If I asked sincerely, and that's the key part, I have to be sincere. I have to have a sincerity of my heart. But if I ask sincerely to have my denials exposed, then they will be exposed. And they'll be exposed within the day. And therefore, I'll be able to find them out very rapidly. It's like God's telling me the thing. I don't have to go and discover it myself. Because by just having the desire with God to tell me, God shows me through that process. And so this is where I feel the majority of people who listen to the information we present about emotional work, unfortunately, they forget to do it with God. And so they go into this process of doing it themselves. And in the process of doing it with yourselves, it does become very convoluted, very difficult, very frustrating, and sometimes, so annoying that you want to give up many, many times. Whereas I've never had a feeling inside of myself, after the first couple of years of recognizing how I could do it with God, after that point in time, I've never had a feeling inside of myself of frustration about, not finding something or impatience or feeling self-punishing or feeling that I'm not going to ever find out or any of those things because I know if I have a sincere desire in me, God will show me today. And that makes it really simple. So while I agree it's very complicated if you had to do it all yourself, I feel it's actually very simple when you start to engage God in the process sincerely. Yeah.
And the comment I had also about it's a long route. Will it ever come to a time where we get rid of all the addiction? It
yes.
To me that there will always be. No?
No, no. If you think of yourself as a bottle full of water or half full of water, let's say it's half full of water, and all of that half full water is all, you know, addictions and demands and things about love and you know all these false beliefs that we have, all this untruth that we have in us. Obviously, the speed at which this will get tipped out will depend on the timing of when it becomes empty. So if I tip this out very slowly and just dribble it out, drop, 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 then probably 10 years later it'll still be drop, 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 right? And so, of course, you know, that is going to mean it's a long time. But it's a finite bottle. There's a finite amount of injury within each of us, an infinite amount. And the reason why it's not an infinite amount is because we are finite beings at this point in time, and we are not infinite like God is. And so therefore, there must be a finite amount of injury inside of us. And as long as we keep tipping it out, eventually it will be empty. If we never engage the process of tipping it out, then of course it will remain with the contents as long as we don't engage the process. And if we engage the process very slowly, and we just drop, 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 then of course the process is going to be quite a long process. But if we engage the process as rapidly as God feeds us the information and allow ourselves to be overwhelmed through that process, and
that's dependent on what? Desire.
Desire, only desire. And if we engage the process as rapidly as God presents the information to us, then we have the ability for this to happen over a very short period of time in comparison to our life. So let's say we've lived 50 years, or in my case, 50 years, then there's a potential that within 10 years, I could have, and in my case, I've got 2,000 years of stuff to address, and the reality is, in the first century, I had like about 20-something years of stuff to address, and I addressed it all in 10 years, right? In this life, I've been going 8 years so far addressing the stuff that I've had to deal with over the last 2,000 years, of course, though. So there's a bit more emotion there. So even if it takes me another 10 years, in comparison to my whole life, it's a very minor part of my life. But you see, I feel one of the things that affect most of us, particularly in Western society, is we do expect everything to be instant.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we now have instant almost everything, is because we have this addiction to, you know, if we don't have something happen today or tomorrow, then we sort of believe that, oh, we might as well give it up then. And I feel we need to have a bit more patience with ourselves than that, and a bit more understanding of ourselves, and understanding that these emotions hurt, and that we're going to have to grow in our capacity to experience pain. But in doing that, we can tip it out as rapidly as God delivers it, and God does not deliver it more rapidly than what we can actually cope with. Even though many of you believe that you're being overwhelmed all the time, God is actually saying, no, no, I feel you can cope with some more, actually.
Much more, in most cases.
And if we allow that to occur at God's speed, then it will happen very rapidly. Most of the time we don't, though. Most of the time we have it occur at our speed, which is often sometimes drop, 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 and sometimes it's nothing at all, and sometimes it's like whoosh, 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 you know, like that. It just depends on the underlying desires that we have about the particular emotions. Now, some of the emotions that we have we want to get rid of straight away, and other emotions we have, we want to remain totally in denial of for a long period of time because of the different beliefs we have and so forth. And don't forget that it's not just about emotion, it's also about beliefs. So some of the beliefs we hold on to now, we don't want to give up. And so while we don't give them up, of course, we can't progress. And that is our own choice. But if we get fed things as rapidly as God can feed us, I mean, which is very rapidly, and we let them go as rapidly as God can assist us to do that, then what happens is that we all potentially, in 10 years' time, could be completely free of every single emotional injury that we currently have right today. Now, if you think of that, it's just like that, such a powerful thing to be at one with, like to have every single person in this audience at one with God. Imagine that in 10 years' time. Right? How many of us? There's probably about 65 here or something like that. 65 around about, I think. you think 65 people in one country at one with God, when one person in the world at one with God in the first century created whole heaps of change both on earth and in the spirit world, how much change do you feel 65 people in that state would take, have? Well, how much impact would they have? Obviously a huge impact. So even if this process now takes 10 years for you, it's still very, very, very much worth it, not only for you, but also for the rest of...
And it's not the kind of thing that you get the reward at the end of the 10 years either.
No, you get the reward as it goes.
The rewards happen as you go. But can I just contrast as well, Jean, I know you want to say some more, but just about addiction, because we're talking a lot about addiction today, and how separate that is actually from emotional injury, or how addiction actually forms a lot of what comes out of us to our environment. That's our demands. That's the things we want to have to help us avoid our real self. It's even our injured self right now. Now, yesterday we talked about, I said, I think I've got a PhD in addictions because I feel like I've been looking at them for 4 years. And I said, AJ doesn't have any. He said, no, that's not really true. I just went through a very intense period in my life where none of them got met and I grieved them all at once. And that's what I was thinking about when you're making the tipping water analogy. If we just look at the area of addiction, because remember yesterday when we had the chart up and we had addiction at the top and then we had fear and grief, and I said, there's a point. There's a point where you reach where you go, I don't want to go upwards anymore towards addiction and anger, and I'm just going to focus down the line towards fear and grief. That's a point where you say addiction's no longer an option for me. It's no longer going to be feeling good for me. And that is a place you can reach really rapidly. Mm. As AJ said, he reached it in a few months?
Yeah, once I made a choice to experience in a truthful manner my emotions... it took about, I think it was about 11 months for me to reach the place of that I no longer would accept any addiction inside of myself. At that moment, my whole life fell apart, like absolutely, the whole life. So I lost my entire life as I knew it at that point.
Is that at the end of the dealing with the addictions or at the beginning?
No, that was at the beginning, yeah. The beginning of dealing with the addictions. There was this desire that occurred and in that place, it took 11 months for me to generate that positive desire of dealing with absolutely every, of wanting to become aware of and deal with absolutely every addiction that I had. In the next few months, it was very intense, as you can imagine, because my entire life fell apart in the next few months in every different area of my life, financially, physically, emotionally, relationship, children, parents, friends, all of the constructions of my life fell apart in a very, very short period of time. It took me, and I pretty much began crying from that point on for quite some time. And during that phase, it took another probably 11 months for me to get through all of those things that came up from those particular events. Once that began to happen. And by the way, I was still in denial about a lot of things. During that phase, I was still in denial about who I was even, right? Because that happened, another layer happened underneath that. So I had to go through this first layer to actually ever get to the second one.
Which was actually about giving up your addictions, really, in that 11 months. Everything fell apart, no addictions were met. The grief of having no addictions met happened. Then the door opened for truth.
Yeah.
And that's something that I wanted to say to you guys. Sorry, were you finished?
Yeah, yeah. My life started changing after that in a positive direction. So I started having joy reappear in my life after I was prepared to address all of those things.
And that's why I felt so inspired to talk to you guys about this today, because this is where joy happens after addiction is dealt with. And you can't have it any other order. And that's why it's so important. And I see AJ did it in 11 months. I'm like plotting my way through it in what feels like a very intense 4 years, and I see a lot of people out there kind of dipping their toe in. And I
don't feel I've done it in 11 months, because I feel there was that second layer of addiction that I had, which was another time in my life. So after the first layer of addiction, I then started to work my way through a lot of different issues, demands that I had, and all of these kind of things. And then that just built up until my life was relatively happy again. And I was quite happy. I was enjoying my life, embracing my life in a lot of different areas during that phase of my life. I became a multimillionaire because of just the law of attraction changed with regard to monetary issues, my sense of worth, and all those kind of things. And that brought me to the point of being ready to handle the next set of addictions. And that process took, you know, that was when I realized I was Jesus, and I realized all those kind of realizations that I had. And that took me another like 12 or 14, 15 months to actually process my way through that. But because I was no longer addicted to even feeling good, it just went through it like a freight train, really. And people around me, of course, were concerned. Like, you know, my mother wanted to throw me in a psychiatric ward, and people around me were concerned, but I wasn't concerned because I'd already been through the process once before. I knew what it was like. I knew what I could expect through the process, that I was just going to have to embrace this new process. And so, so once I covered those second set of addictions, then it's become much, much easier to enjoy life and much, much easier to embrace desire and passion as a result.
Yeah. So my point is really, you're not going to feel joy unless you're willing to go through intensity around addictions. Mm. Your soul doesn't work like that. And when you're trying to bite off little pieces of the past, you just end up feeding other addictions instead of having this heartfelt desire to really become unnumb, to become sensitive again and to really know yourself. Mm. And that's the step that has to happen, I feel, to actually progress towards God, towards yourself. But if, as AJ was saying, if you involve God in that process, it's far richer, it's far more rapid. It's
And it's simple because you don't have to, like in the first, you remember I described those two phases. In the first phase, I didn't really involve God much. So I was having to work everything out. I finished up visiting, psychiatrists and psychologists to see what they could tell me. And then after a while, they couldn't tell me much. And then I went and, asked all of my friends what they observed in me and all those kind of things. And, and often they'd tell me things and express themselves, which was really good. And then, but I still was doing it by having to use my mind and my intellect to work out myself, to struggle to find myself. In the second phase, I went through this process of really coming to trust God again in my life. And once I went through the second phase, it was very interesting because after that point, it was so much more simple because all I had to do is trust that God would show me the next thing if I had a desire to know the next thing. So I actually gave up trying to work it all out, actually, during that process. I gave up trying to discover. I gave up trying to know, what it was all about. And all I did was trust that God would show me if I had a sincere desire. So all I worked on was having a sincere desire. That was my main focus. Having a sincere desire to get out of denial into looking at what's really going on. And in that phase, all I had to do was that trust today, God would, whatever I desired to know today, God would show me. And always has been the case since then. And so once I entered that phase, it was like I could become a child again. It was like the other phase in the first time that I went through these breaking down of addictions and so forth, I was still really an adult working my way through life. But in the second phase, I've sort of just become a child again, a trusting child, trusting his father, that his father would show him everything that he needs to know. And once I got into that phase, then life also became a lot more enjoyable. I started embracing my true nature, my true personality, my true self. I had a lot less fear about everyone around me and what they were thinking of me and what they were doing with what I, what they were observing, what I was doing. As you can imagine, I got condemned a lot, right, through this process. And I gave up even that, the whole desire for have anybody think well of me. And because I could feel my growing relationship with God was that God was actually showing me what to do next every single time. And all I had to do was embrace what he showed me and not have any resistance to it. That's all I had to do. And once I started embracing that, things started changing for me in a very big way. And it was like 3 years after that, or 4 years after that, that I actually attracted Mary into my life, because I still had a lot of work to do to remove the grief-based emotions. So I still had a lot of grief, and I did a lot of grief work. But now I at least trusted that God would show me the next thing I had to grieve, or the next thing that I was able to deal with and needed to deal with. Yeah. So that's what we'd like to encourage you to do.
Yeah. Jean, did you still have more you want to say?
One more thing to ask, which is, I think, very important.
Yeah.
How do you feel when you don't have these addictions? So what's the benefit? What's the overall goal?
It's amazing, actually.
And that's the value. That's the incentive.
Yeah. I still have some addictions, so I must point that out still. But I have a memory of what life was like without them, as does Mary. But even with life as it is now for me, I don't have any feelings of self-consciousness at all. Like, in other words, you can just be yourself, absolutely who you are, with everybody you meet, without even having to think about it or think about their response to it or worry about their response or if they're angry, upset or whatever. You don't even have to worry about any of that either. It's just like you can just be exactly you. So that's a huge, like, amazing place to be, particularly when you've had a life where you've never felt like you've been able to be you, and not having to think about everything all the time is an amazing thing. Like, to actually live in harmony with love almost all of the time. So right now, I can live in harmony with love almost all the time. I've still got some addictions to go. Most of them are with God, but I can live in harmony with love almost all the time without having to think about it. Like, it's an automatic process without having to try. Mm. Imagine if you just give up having to try and giving up having to try to be loving. Like, once you become at one with God and got all rid of all the addictions, you don't... It's like you're going through the world, you're totally conscious of everything that's going on around you, and none of it bothers you. None of it affects you negatively in any way. And you are just being yourself every single moment without having to try, without having to force yourself to be. And you also, in that same place, know that you're so connected with God that everything you do is totally in harmony with love with every single person you meet. So you don't have to try to be loving anymore. There's just so much happiness in that place. It's like, it's... Like, in my first century life, it was unimaginable for me to even imagine what I could have been like. And then when I became it, it was like the first time you do it is just so amazing. Like, because the first time you do it, you've got no concept of what life could have been like that. Right? For myself and Mary and others who have returned, obviously we do have a concept, and so there's a feeling of loss within us about that particular life. But the first time you do it, it's just joy once you get to that condition. It's sort of like, wow, like, I never imagined life could be this way, right? And it's way beyond your wildest dreams of what you're capable of doing is the things you finish up doing. Because there's no limitation, there's no fear anymore, there's no addictions guiding your life. And remember that all of God's laws are constraining your addictions. All of God's laws are pulling you back into love, and so they're all trying to expose your addictions all the time. And so you don't feel like anything in the universe is working against you. It's an amazing feeling that is too. Like, everything that you set your heart to do happens in that place. Everything. And in the celestial spirit realm, that's exactly what it's like. Every single thing you set your heart to do, because everything you set your heart to do is loving, it happens. Every single thing. Like, imagine a life like that. You know, in the life we have now, most of us go, oh, yes, you know, like, oh, I wish I could do this, and I wish I could do that, and I wish I could do this. In the celestial spirit realm, you don't even know the word wish. You know, it doesn't even exist as a word, because everything you do happens. Everything you desire happens. It's not a wish. It's almost like a command, but it's not a command either. It just happens. So it's an amazing place to be, and I'd really encourage all of you to consider going through the trauma, and I understand it is trauma, to go through the trauma of becoming aware, so getting out of denial, go into the trauma of having to look at all of your addictions and see how, you know, terrible they look and everything. Go into the trauma of feeling your terror and down into your grief, because the rewards of doing so are unimaginable at the moment for you. And as long as you can begin to embrace the process, you'll realise those rewards. Now, what myself and Mary are trying to do is demonstrate to you those rewards by doing it ourselves, again, in front of you, in front of a worldwide audience, so that you can at least understand the benefits of it as we go.
And there are many benefits as you go. What AJ is describing is the end point. Mm. But even now, myself, having dealt with many addictions, and certainly not by any means all of them, remember yesterday I talked about this joy that suddenly becomes apparent and desire that is just now present in my life. And all of that was once suppressed by addiction, but by fear of what other people would think and placating to all of these other things of what I thought I had to be or should be so I could get love. And just the joy, I feel there is so much joy in any person once they begin to reconnect with themselves. And even if that self is afraid and sad, there is a joy in that, because you've spent years and years of your life numb to it. Just that reconnection to it is a joyful place. Mm. And you do feel more empowered to make your own decisions. And empowered to this desire, this perfect desire that you have at the end, that's completely in harmony with love and God, that is immediately fulfilled. Well, the beginnings of that start to happen. Mm. You start to have desires in harmony with love, and some of them in disharmony with love, and you get to test that out. You get to start into this whole before, when you're in addiction, you're trying to have a relationship, a very flawed relationship with everyone around you, and God can't even enter the stadium. It's just all about everyone around you and avoidance of self. As soon as you start to let go of that, it's like the roof comes off and God can start to interact with you in your life and start to give you feedback on different things. And your relationships with people around you change also. Mm. Suddenly they can connect to you and you have the potential of connecting to them. Mm. When you're in addiction, that can't happen. You're operating in addiction, which is not you and not them. Mm-hmm. So there's actually the possibility, and that's joyful. That's joyful. And you're not even yet at one with God, which is why I said you don't have to wait 10 years to get the good stuff. Mm-hmm. Even though there's pain and fear along the way, there's immediately more joy. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, there's so many benefits immediately as well as in the long term. And I feel like if we allow ourselves to begin the process sincerely, you will actually start discovering the immediate benefits. And we haven't even listed the benefits associated with the benefits of growing closeness in a personal relationship with another person, the growing closeness in your relationship with yourself and understanding yourself, your growing ability to have less cares, you know, like less fears in your
less
life,
worry,
to have less worry in your life is an amazing thing, to actually have a life where there's no worry, where you're not worried about anything, literally not worried, you know, where you don't have to be afraid of what's going on in your life. So these are all like also benefits that come and grow over time. Mm. Yeah. Mm. So, yeah. I gave a talk recently about the eternal benefits of having a relationship with God. As well, and all of those benefits are also included in this process. So, yeah.
I just wanted to wrap up. I want to recap. But does anyone else have other questions before we? There's a few. Do we have time?
Well, I'm busting to go to the toilet, actually, as are some of you, I know. We've been going close to 3 hours, have we?
What time is it?
2:30. Yeah. Right, yeah. So, so perhaps it's a good time to finish off and you to recap.
Yep.
And then we can get on to the second subject, because if we don't leave the subject, we'll never get to the second subject.
Yeah.
So
there's more. So, all right, if I just recap, because there was a few really important things that were said in this process of getting out of denial, recognizing addiction, and really starting your real soul work. It doesn't start till that happens. So one of the beautiful things AJ said was do it with God, with you and with your heart and not your head. And that speaks to what I was saying to Liz about you have to open your heart to the desire to want this. And most of us don't have that desire yet, or it would already be happening. We're still afraid about it. So it's involving God in developing that desire. Second thing to note is if we have the sincere desire, God's going to show us immediately. So if we're not getting shown, we know, okay, I've got to go back to the first thing, desire. It's not there yet. And then when we have desire, it's growing. Like I said to Marina yesterday, be on the lookout. Like, don't walk around without, you know, head down, not really looking at what's happening. Notice what's happening in my interactions. Because the third thing I want to say to you is, if the injury or if the addiction or if the emotion, if I say, is in me, this is a big truth that I got, took me a while to get this in my soul, it must come out sometime. So if it's there, it's going to have to come out. And I can't really work around it. And remember I said in the beginning I wanted to work around the addictions and just get to the grieving bit because that seemed fairly safe, not terrifying, few Kleenex in the corner, it would be okay. Didn't have to face the judgment, the shame of all the addiction I'd been living in. Didn't have to feel terrified about all these other things. But it doesn't work. If the feeling is in me, if the addiction exists, I'm going to have to feel about it for it to leave me. If terror is in me, I'm going to have to feel that for it to leave me. And I can't do it any other way. And that's why I say, look around you. Because if you notice, if I'm having an exchange with AJ and I notice, oh, something's a bit off here, there's something here for me, oh, well, I'll go on and talk to someone else. I've just missed an opportunity that God gave me to have the emotion come out to me, at least to get out of denial and into awareness, because I'm going to have to start this process sometime. And if I keep skipping over opportunities, God's going to keep bringing me more. And he's going to, Josh in Australia says, first he brings you a feather, then he brings you a brick, then he brings you a truck. So, you know, I can engage with the feather and not have to wait for the steamroller to show me what's going on in my life. So, that was the other thing I wanted to encourage you to feel about and to recognize as a truth in your heart. If this is in me, it's going to come out. It's going to have to come out of me. So the more I keep denying, the more I've probably got an issue with that, but I don't really want to face it yet. I'm just prolonging pain in my life. And that's the last thing that I wanted to say to you, I think. No, there's one more.
You've got to go, sorry, darling.
it's something that AJ said. There's what if change isn't happening in my life, it's not happening in my soul. Gosh, I'm not used to this writing on the board thing that AJ was happening in life. It's not happening in my soul. Conversely, if suddenly things just get really shaken up, if I grow this desire and suddenly everything falls apart, I go, oh, right, thanks God. This is God now working with me. This is not a bad thing because I know I've been in denial and addiction for the entirety of my life probably, so it's going to get a bit messy while that gets shaken up. So I can go, okay, that means that I'm ready. God knows better than me when I'm ready for change, and he's bringing me these opportunities right now, and I can engage with them. Which brings me to the last thing, which is just simply, don't settle. I see that in a lot of people that we meet because I was like it inside of myself. I settled for a life that I thought was reasonably okay, that I could have this level of happiness, which now feels like it was not happy at all. But I kind of kidded myself that this is kind of happy and maybe you can't really hope for much more in life. I really settled for this. I wasn't even in contact with my real passion, my real desire in my life. And I see a lot of people doing this. They go, even some of them open Pandora's box of their soul and see a little bit of truth. And then they go, that's too hard. I'll wait for the spirit world. Or I'll get to that after I deal with this other emotion or this emotion. And then I'll get to the really hard stuff. And that's all just settling. It's just saying, and it's not having faith that God created you to be able to do it. Because he did. And he doesn't want you to settle. That's why he created the law of attraction, to keep showing you and keep showing you and keep showing you. He's saying, don't settle for this, what you've got now, because I created you with far more potential than this. Recognize what's here. Recognize what's inside of you, because when you do that, big change is going to happen and you're going to feel joy. And you're going to start to feel joy even when you're not fully healed yet. But when you settle, you completely disengage. And you have to generate more and more levels of addiction and denial to remain in that kind of life. Because God's keeping on bringing you the triggers and you keep going, no, I'm happy here, I'm happy here, I'm happy here. And that's more denial and that's more addiction. So if I can just inspire you, don't settle for not so happy, kind of okay in your relationship, sort of financially all right, but not really living your dreams. Don't settle for that. God created you to have an amazing existence. And the minute you start engaging this process is the minute you start working with the potential he put in you, not the potential you say you've got. Because trust me, his idea of what you're capable of is way bigger than what you feel you're capable of. So if I can just leave you with that. And yeah. Thank you, guys.
Yes, guys.